Thank you, and good evening, and welcome to the fourth installment of this chronological journey through the Beethoven String Quartets. Tonight we are going to begin in 1809, which is a year that for Beethoven began rather well and ended rather badly. For the Viennese populace in general, it was a year that began with the economy teetering precariously, and also war was in the air again. Napoleon's troops were on the march. Many of the people who were living in Vienna were considering leaving at that point, Beethoven included. He really was looking for a court position someplace where he would have a stable salary and would be out of harm's way and could write in peace. And interestingly, that season he received just such an offer from this gentleman here, Jerome Bonaparte. He was the king of Westphalia. He was the younger brother of Napoleon, who had actually installed him in that position. He was in Kassel, the capital city, and he was looking for ways to improve the condition of the infrastructure of the city, and also he wanted to change it overnight into a cultural center. And so he hit on this great idea that if he could lure Beethoven from Vienna, that he would have it made. And so he made Beethoven a rather lavish offer, and there was very few obligations attached to this position, and he even offered him a stipend to travel when he wanted. And it is very difficult to imagine that Beethoven was seriously considering going to work for the kid brother of Napoleon at this time. But he let it be known around Vienna that he was considering the idea. And this had the desired effect. A consortium of his favorite patrons, Princes Kinski, Lobkowitz, and Rudolf, who was to become the Archduke Rudolf, came to him with a counteroffer that he really could not refuse. They gave him 4,000 florins in return for the agreement that he would stay in Vienna. And so on March the 1st, 1809, he signed an annuity agreement with these gentlemen, and for a little while he was feeling financially secure, even flush enough to consider getting married. He was 39 years old. He must have been thinking, I am soon to be deleted from the marriageable catalog. It's now or never. And this dream of financial security and domestic bliss lasted for approximately 6 weeks. At that time, Napoleon's army massed outside of Vienna, and the people who were still in Vienna, particularly the nobles and the aristocrats, began to leak out of Vienna. One of the people who fled on May the 4th was Archduke Rudolf. He was really Beethoven's favorite patron because to the extent that was possible between a member of the royal family and a commoner, they were friends. And also, Rudolf was somewhat younger than Beethoven and was an avid admirer of him and studied composition and piano with Beethoven. And Beethoven had a great deal of affection for him. He had an almost fatherly attitude towards this gentleman. And so he wrote the first movement of his 26th piano sonata in E-flat major, which he gave a subtitle to, Lebewohl, Farewell. He presented it to him on the day that he left. And it begins with that word sketched out across the first three descending notes of the piece. So he left on May the 4th. 1 week later, Napoleon brought his howitzers up right to the outskirts of the city, and he unleashed a terrible bombing campaign, went all night, sent those who had not escaped to their basements. Beethoven himself went to the basement of his brother Karl, and he spent the night holding pillows against his head, trying to protect what was left of his already severely damaged hearing. Haydn was 77 years old at the time, in frail physical condition, living outside in this house, outside the city limits. And over the course of the evening, a cannonball fell into his courtyard, exploded. And he was so jangled by that experience that 3 weeks later, on May the 31st, he died. And so the Viennese surrendered. Napoleon's armies rolled into Vienna. They occupied the city. They levied steep taxes. They devalued the value of the currency. And so things got suddenly much worse. And for Beethoven, this dream of financial security evaporated, and he also became unable to write music. And this was rather unusual because over the last decade, he had been almost unbelievably productive. Most of the great heroic middle period pieces that we associate with Beethoven were already behind him at this point. And so he wrote, perhaps a little sheepishly, to Breitkopf and Hertel, his publisher, and he said, "We have passed through a great deal of misery. Since the 4th of May, I have brought forth into the world very little that is connected, only a fragment here or there. The whole course of events has affected me, body and soul. What a disturbing wild life all around me, nothing but drums, cannons, men, misery of all sorts." 4 months later, things had begun to improve somewhat. Things had calmed down a bit. Rudolf came back, and he began to write music again. And he was in a very E-flat major-ish frame of mind, apparently, because all of the pieces he was writing were in that key. He completed the Lebewohl sonata in E-flat major and presented it to Rudolf on his return. He also completed his Emperor Piano Concerto, E-flat major, presented that also to Rudolf, dedicated it to him. And he completed his 10th string quartet, Opus 74, subtitled subsequently the Harp. This string quartet is perhaps a little bit less well known than its neighbors. It has, I think, the misfortune to fall into this trough between the Razumovsky trilogy, which were so revolutionary that they just scared everybody and continue to do so today, and the Opus 95 Serioso Quartet, which is this furious outpouring, the shortest but the most intense of his quartets. And I think perhaps it is analogous to the position of the Fourth Symphony, also a wonderful symphony, but it has that same misfortune of falling between the Eroica Symphony, this great trend-breaking masterpiece, and the Fifth Symphony, which we all know. So the Fourth Symphony and the E-flat major Opus 74 string quartet are perhaps a little bit less known, but they are both wonderful. This quartet is a real honey of a quartet, very sensuously beautiful, almost impressionist in its approach to sonority. And it's also, I think, more accessible on the surface than this trilogy of Razumovsky quartets, and I believe it was intended to be so because his money was running out at this point. He had basically poisoned the waters with regard to these amateur connoisseurs who bought his quartets because the Razumovsky quartets were just impossible for them to wrap their minds or their techniques around. So this one perhaps was intended to be more accessible all around, which is in no way to denigrate the piece. It begins a little mysteriously. It seems to test the waters. It's a bit tentative at the beginning. We have an opening phrase, and then he backs off, and there's a moment of silence. Eventually, as we move through this introduction, the music begins to move more reassuringly. It flows ahead. And yet, from time to time, we have these giant chords that fall out of the sky like guillotine blades and slice off the proceedings. Thank you. finally, we get to the exposition proper, Allegro, and it begins very confidently now. We have a little fanfare, E-flat major, establishes the key beyond a shadow of a doubt, and then the music begins to roll ahead, and we have a flowing second violin line, and all in eighth notes. We have a lovely melody up in the first violin. The cello sustains a drone. The second violin moves up. It's sort of a composite melody that makes use of all four components of the string quartet, warm and amiable and flowing. And then we get to the part that tells us why later generations called it the Harp Quartet. And I mentioned that he uses rather impressionist approach to sonority in this piece. This is a piece that would not stand up well to transcription because it is so intimately related to the sound and the capabilities of string instruments themselves, particularly in its use of pizzicato. In this transitional section that follows, you'll see pizzicato in dialogue between cello and viola, and then between the two violins. And this pizzicato texture becomes the signature texture of this first movement, and we hear it all the way through. And as we approach the recapitulation after the development section, we hear it most dramatically bubbling up from the cellos, and then it begins to simmer, and then it begins to boil, and finally it boils over, and we arrive back into that composite, warm, amiable, flowing first theme. The second movement is warm and flowing. It's in the subdominant key of A flat major, which is sort of an ecstatic relationship to the first movement, and it has an elegiac quality to it. And this may relate to the fact that Haydn had just died. You recall, if you were at the first conversation in the first string quartet concert, that Beethoven came in 1792 at the age of 22 to Vienna from his hometown of Bonn, specifically to study with Haydn. And you may also recall that it didn't work out very well. And he left Haydn's tutelage and he went on and he began to study with a lesser composer, perhaps a more suitable pedagogue, Albrecht Berger. But this, you know, early on he had established a rocky relationship with Haydn, who was 60 years old, and although an amiable man, certainly couldn't help to have been, he must have felt dissed. And as Beethoven went along, we see in his music that he had nothing but the highest respect for Haydn. On that same first concert, we heard Opus 18, number 2, the G major quartet, which is very much modeled after Haydn's musical sensibilities and his wit and his humor. But again, they didn't get along very well over the course of Haydn's life. And I think perhaps Beethoven may have regretted that. And this piece, I think it is easy to believe that it was written so much in the wake of Haydn's death that it was intended as an elegy. And you will recall that farewell motive, this Lebewohl. From his sonata dedicated to Rudolf when he was leaving. You hear this configuration all over this piece. I'll play you this melody, and towards the end, you will hear it here and there. I will point it out when it comes. Here. here. Possibly. I mean, we will see later on in the fourth movement a more explicit use of that motive again, and you can make up your minds about whether or not it was intended as a tribute to Haydn. As we move through this second movement, this lovely elegiac melody comes back at regular intervals, like a rondo, and it's almost like a theme in variations as well, because each time it comes back, as you'll hear and as you'll see, he changes the style of it and he ornaments it in a different way. The second time we hear it, about 3 minutes into the movement, it is now in a warm, flowing, tripletized version. And 3 minutes later, we hear it again, now down in the lowest register of the first violin, throaty, and it sounds almost like a viola solo. And the second violin, as you'll see, is actually above the first violin, playing this chirpy, rather avian ornamentation. And the viola and cello are trading back and forth pizzicati, which again brings back this subliminal reference to the first movement. Warm elegiac A flat major, we go for the third movement down to stormy C minor. It's a very quick scherzo. He divides the melody into bars that are, they subdivide into 3/4 time very quickly, and then he divides the bars into 6/8 time. He doesn't change the meter specifically, but you hear the bar divided in half. It's a metrical ambiguity that apparently appealed to Schubert when he heard this piece. We know Schubert as the master of modal ambiguity, always vacillating between major and minor. Perhaps he was intrigued by this metrical ambiguity. To me, it's very intense. It sounds almost like Verdi. And the trio is even faster. He marks it più presto quasi prestissimo. And he also writes, feel it as if it's in 6/8. But I think he doesn't write it in 6/8. As you'll see, it goes by in this frenzy of quarter notes. I think because as the player reads this fast-moving wall of quarter notes, it looks even faster to him than if he had written it in 6/8. And we hear in the viola this archaic sounding cantus firmus that is tolling like bells across this stream of frenzied quarter notes. The fourth movement is the only theme and variations movement that he used to conclude a string quartet. And again, I will remind you of the Lebewohl motive one more time. As we listen to the theme, you hear it everywh�. Thank you. we're looking at it, so you can see that the second beat of the measure is the one that's getting the accent, and the downbeat is de-emphasized. When we only hear it, it is an odd effect. It sounds almost like he's displaced the downbeat. We're not quite sure where it is. And then he lines up these six variations like the hedges in a classical formal garden, alternating always loud, always soft. I'll give you the Reader's Digest distillation of these six variations so you can see what I mean by that. Coda is a mad fortissimo dash to the finish line, except he plays one final Haydn-esque joke on us, which is at the very last possible second, he pulls out the dynamic rug from under us and he gives us a whispering, respectful conclusion. Now, the next quartet he wrote was composed the following year, 1810. And this is the F minor quartet that he gave a title to, Serioso. And it is such a dark and furious piece, and so avant-garde for its time, it really predicts the late quartets in its extreme concision and its use of contrast. And he didn't even publish it for 6 years after he wrote it. He just kept it in the drawer. And as to why he wrote it, I'll tell you a little bit more what was going on in his life at this time, and perhaps you can speculate. You recall back in 1810, in March the 1st, he signed that annuity contract, and he was feeling financially secure, and he began to think it was time to get married. And he had a very bad history with women. He kept falling in love with women who were unavailable or unsuitable or simply uninterested in him. And he did that again. He fell in love with this woman. I think she was about 20 at the time, Teresa Malfatti. She was the cousin of his doctor. She was a piano student of his, quite a looker, as you see. And as usual, she admired Beethoven as an artist, but she had no interest in him as a man. And as usual, he was oblivious to that fact. And so he courted her, and he pursued her, and he proposed to her, and she turned him down flat. And this, again, precipitated this downward spiral. And so he devoted himself completely during 1810 to three pieces of music. And I think, in a way, each of these pieces can be thought of as a symbol of what was going on in his life externally or internally. The first of the three he wrote from the beginning of the year until June took him about 6 months. It was the incidental music to Goethe's Egmont. And this story is about the Flemish nobleman, the real-life nobleman, Count Egmont, who foresees the liberation of the Netherlands from Spanish tyranny, and he dies in a brave stand against that tyranny. And it begins in dark, lamenting, powerful F minor in a musical depiction of Spanish tyranny. Like Fidelio, it traces this arc from tyranny to liberation and triumph, and we hear that reflected in a change from F minor to F major. I think it's rather easy to imagine that at this time, when Vienna was under the occupation of the French, that he saw a metaphor there in this piece. Another piece he wrote in 1810 was Opus 97, his warm, benign Archduke trio, again in E flat major, again dedicated to his friend Archduke Rudolf. And if this benign, noble, massive music represents Beethoven's superego at work, the F minor quartet, pugilistic and violent and angry, I think represents his wild, untamed id. It is in every respect the opposite of the Archduke trio. That piece is massive and expansive and noble, and this piece is compressed and angry, and in the spirit of compression, its major signature interval, the interval we hear everywhere, is that of the semitone, the minor second, which has this association with sighing and moaning, re, do, and we hear it everywhere. Immediately after we hear that spasmodic gesture at the beginning, he ratchets it up a half step to G flat major, the so-called Neapolitan key, and then you hear arpeggios bubbling up from the cello, and the first violin is reaching pleadingly across the bar lines in these imploring gestures, these half steps, these semitones. And then the music goes careening back into the opening spasmodic gesture in F minor, and then he turns up the crank like on a torture machine to G flat and then ratchets it up to G natural. And then with no transition whatsoever, we find ourselves catapulted up into D flat major, which is a much more ecstatic music. And it is warm and yearning, and we hear this expansive melody in the viola and then in the cello. And all the while, you'll see the first violin is going up to its highest register and hovering over the proceedings like a guardian angel. Smashing back into that violent, pugilistic opening. And this movement is very short, and in the end it just collapses in a heap like an exhausted street fighter. And the following movement begins as an extension of that. The cello is all by himself, and it sounds like he is panting from the exertion. Starting in the cautiously optimistic key of D major, but then we go into this very poignant melody which vacillates, like Schubert, back and forth between major and minor. It's very indeterminate in its modality. Just can't make up its mind, and we've come from this very violent first movement Rocky, and now we are Hamlet here. And as we move through this second movement, we come to D minor, a rather tragic key. And he provides a fugue at this point. We hear it first in the viola, and then we hear it in the second violin, and then down in the cello. And once again, everything is comprised of minor seconds, of these groaning semitones. I've circled them wherever I could find them, and you'll see that it is just a sea of red circles. This movement doesn't really end. It comes to a pausing point on a diminished seven chord, a rather unresolved dissonant sound. And then we move into the next movement. And rather than resolving it, he simply pounces on it and he pounds it into the floor for 17 whole bars until we finally come careening back into the original dark key of F minor. See this theme, this thematic component, ba-ba-da, ba-ba-da. Again, he's displacing our sense of where the downbeat is. It sounds like an upbeat going to a downbeat, but the downbeat is on the second beat of the measure. And so after he has bullied us into believing that that's where it is, then he suddenly goes back to the first beat of the measure, giving us the metrical equivalent of whiplash. And from this stormy sea of anxiety, we go into the trio, and it really has this sense of being a prayer for relief from this storm. And the last movement provides no relief from all of this anxiety. It feels like if an intensification of this psychic distress that we're in. The music is haunted, and it feels, you know, really like we're on the verge of a nervous breakdown now, just hanging on by our fingernails. And then you will remember how the Egmont Overture written earlier that year went from F minor into a triumphant F major. And this does the same. However, it is such a manic conclusion, this coda, and so utterly unexpected that it really has a disorienting feeling. It feels almost, you know, Looney Tunes. It's very surprising. Surprising, and it has given musicologists a lot of trouble. Some of them are just, they just don't like it. They wish he'd done something else. The ever curmudgeonly Vincent Dondi wrote of it, "One might imagine that some light Rossinian finale had strayed into this atmosphere of sustained beauty." we think that no interpretation could palliate this error of genius, which I think is a little rough. Not an error, but I think perhaps an intensification of the basic Beethovenian paradigm, which is that sorrow and joy, pain and redemption are really opposite sides of the same coin, and that you can't have pain and sorrow and redemption and joy without each other. From this point on, he wrote no more string quartets for 15 years until 1825. And during this period, he went through a lot of pain, some redemption, but a lot of pain. For instance, his hearing, which was very bad at this point, went away. So bad was it that he had to give up performing. He couldn't play the piano. He really was not effective as a conductor anymore. And he, if he wanted to carry on conversations, people had to write to him in conversation books because he couldn't hear what they were saying. Also, his love life became ever more complicated. He did fall in love with a woman around 1812 who loved him back. And she even threatened to marry him. And he, it may have been this woman, it's not clear who she was. He referred to her in this letter to the immortal beloved without name. And it was very difficult for him because he had to come to terms with the fact that he was really married to his art and that he was not suitable for marriage. And so he turned her down, but this rippled outwards in his psyche for years and years to come and really cast a pall over him. And he was so, he knew he wasn't going to have a family, but his brother Carl died in 1815, and he latched onto the notion that he could become a surrogate father for his nephew, Carl von Beethoven. And he developed terrible antipathy towards Carl's mother, Johanna. He decided that she was a corrupting influence on the boy, and he tried to wrench him away from her, and he didn't want to go, and she didn't want to let him go. And this went on torturously for 5 years and took a lot of psychic energy. And finally, in 1820, he was awarded custody of the child, and that was not the end of the story. I'll tell you the end of the story at the final concert. Also, 1815 was the year that Wellington defeated Napoleon at Waterloo, and this inspired a series of politically inspired but musically rather uninspired potboilers that he wrote at that time, one of which was Wellington's Victory, this battle symphony that he wrote, and another was a perfectly awful opera called Germania, the less about which is said, perhaps the better. And the Viennese public being what it was, they loved this music and they elevated him to the height of celebrity. And then they got tired of him and they dropped him back down to the ground. And he ended up going into this terrible fallow period during which he really was not able to write at all for quite a while. And finally he began to come out of this. He wrote his two cello sonatas, Opus 102, and his Hammerklavier sonata, which were like the gateway to this late spiritually elevated period. And it really got rolling around 1820 when he wrote his three final piano sonatas, and then he wrote his Diabelli variations, and then these very big public pieces, the Missa Solemnis and its secular counterpart, the Ninth Symphony. And these, of course, were very well received, and so now he was back up on top. And one would expect that he would have just gone on writing more symphonies and huge, successful public pieces, but he didn't do that. He spent the last 2.5 years of his life writing string quartets and taking us to the far outer limits of the known musical galaxy. And the impetus for this was a letter that he received in November of 1822 from this gentleman, Prince Nikolai Borisovich Galitzin. He wrote, "Being a passionate amateur and an admirer of your talent, I am taking the liberty of writing to you to ask if you would be willing to compose 1, 2, or 3 string quartets. I shall be delighted to pay you for the trouble, whatever amount you would deem adequate." So Beethoven accepted the commission. They arranged for a price. He was given a retainer, and then he proceeded not to write the string quartets for about 2 years. And over the course of that, Galitzin just kept writing to him ever more nudgy letters in which he would say, "Where are my string quartets?" And Beethoven said, I'll get around to them. They're coming, not to worry. He was writing the Ninth Symphony. Finally, in February of 1825, he completed the E-flat major opus 127 quartet, the first of the late quartets. Ironically, by this time, Galitzin had gone bankrupt and disappeared. So Beethoven was never paid for these quartets directly. His estate was reimbursed by the estate of Galitzin in 1852, long after either both of them had died. The E-flat major quartet begins a bit as if it were a public piece. It begins with this great set of proclamation chords in E-flat major, which establish the mood, they establish the key. They're a little hard to tell what meter just by listening to it. To me, it sounds as if it's in 5/8 and then in 3/8. And this grand stentorian beginning is completely deceptive because it immediately evaporates. We have this trill and then it just blends into this intimate conversation between a few friends, very lyrical and very warm, and the word intimate is, I think, the right word. This formula of grand proclamation chords followed by melting lyricism happens three times over the course of this first movement, and each time it gets bigger, it's done on a larger scale. We go from E-flat major at the beginning, which is a key with no open strings, to at the beginning of the development, like another pillar in the structure, we have G major, which has lots of open strings and is orchestrated more thickly with triple stops as opposed to double stops. And then again, it melts into that lovely melody. Later, at another structural juncture, we have it in C major, even bigger, even louder, fortissimo that time. Between this first lyrical melody and the G major pillar, there is a second theme, which is in G minor, which is really not all that far removed from E flat major. It's darker, it's in minor, but as you'll hear, the texture is similar, and it is similarly flowing and lyrical. It's not really a contrasting second theme. As you'll see, throughout this quartet, with the exception of the third movement, this overarching lyricism is really the code word, as well as this textural homogeneity. At this point in his life, he is breaking down the barriers between what is purely vocal and what is purely instrumental music, and you'll hear that quite a lot in the quartets to come. And this lyricism is amplified in the second movement, which is, I will warn you now, it's about 17 minutes long, so you can be ready for that. It is sensuously beautiful and has one of the most unusual structures. It is essentially a very slow theme and variations. We have a long, expansive melody, and then almost imperceptibly, the first variation begins, and there are six of them. And also, in a larger sense, it is a song form, A, section, B section, A section. A section is in A flat major, B section in E major. The A section returns in A flat. So that'll give you some structural sense of what to expect. The melody itself is unusual for a theme and variations movement because it is in itself so expansive and even contains elements of variation within the melody itself. For instance, you'll hear this lovely sustained A-flat major 12-8 melody going along, and then it goes into the highest register of the cello, and the first violin begins to adopt a counter melody. Such a tender, consoling melody that 3 months after he died, somebody thought it would make a nice song and gave it a title, Beethoven's Homecoming, and gave it words which begin, "His spirit turns away from the manacles of the earth." And once it's done, the first variation just grows out of it. 16th notes begin to move, and they accrue around the melody like the tendrils of a vine. The second variation is it's almost a little military. It feels like a march, and we have a dialogue between the first two, the top two violins. And then when we get to the end of this second variation in A flat major, it pivots harmonically without any transition to the furthest point on the harmonic compass. He goes from A flat major to E major, which is really a tritone away. You can't get any further than that. And it becomes very hymn-like and rather religious in its atmosphere. And I think for Beethoven, E major was an ethereal key. If you recall Razumovsky Quartet number 2, Opus 59, number 2, the second movement, he's contemplating the stars. I showed that image of Oliver Sacks looking at the universe. That's in E major, has a similarly hymn-like religiosity to it. This is really the spiritual high point of this movement and really of the entire quartet. And then just as he pivoted without transition from A flat to E, he pivots without transition from E back into A flat, and the music begins to move ahead, flowing again in 12-8. Thank you. movement, as I mentioned earlier, is the only one that is truly contrasting in its style. It doesn't, it's not lyrical, it's rather dance-like and rather upbeat. And like all of the other movements, it begins with a short introduction, this one consisting of four staccato, pizzicato notes, which set the tone. And then we have what sounds like a fugue theme in the cello, dotted rhythm, rather dancey, jagged, and it is responded to in the viola with that same subject, only he turns it upside down, it is inverted. And it builds and it builds and it becomes more and more obsessively athletic. And it seems at a certain point like everybody in the quartet is doing jumping jacks together. And then it just evaporates. We go from three-quarter time into piano or pianissimo two-quarter time. He compresses it and it's very strange. It sounds like a thought has occurred to him that he has to think about for a second and it just drags him away from the body of the piece entirely. An odd moment. And the trio section, it feels like a little trip to the countryside. It begins with what to me sounds like a swarm of bugs. And then we walk into a village and there's a country dance going on and he participates and then he walks back out into that buggy swarm. Trip to the country, this country music proceeds into the final movement, which is again lyrical, but it also has this sense of country folk dance to it. It begins with another one of these short introductions, which sounds like a call to the dance. And the first theme is very pastoral and flowing and lyrical and good-natured and sort of toe-tapping. This whole last movement is this little garland of one folk song after another. When we get to the second theme, it's like we've walked into the barn and now there's this hoedown going on and it's a Virginia reel or maybe a Vienna reel. From all of this earthy rusticity, the coda suddenly takes us up for this impressionist vision of heaven. And there's a writer I have quoted from time to time, Joseph Kerman. If you're seriously interested in these pieces, he wrote a very impenetrable book that you won't enjoy very much. And for the most part, he is analytical and kind of dry-eyed, but this coda really moved him to what sounds like poetry. He describes this coda as velvet-gloved. And he says, the folk dances suddenly become dreamed or disembodied, the clay of the dancer's shoes whitened into some kind of glittering dust. The exquisitely calculated journey leads to a castle in the clouds, a fantasy world. Thank you. from this rather impressionist glimpse of heaven, he brings us gently back down to earth for a very human, very Beethovenian moment of triumph at the end of the piece. So go enjoy the piece, and I look forward to seeing you again on Friday evening.